Yeah, so there are 8 movies that you can see here. There is one which has a different drift. Can anyone point out to me where is it?
Right here.
Right.
So the top right, right? So if I can use the pointer here. This. Okay, so this one was a little easy. Let's try another one.
This one, southeast.
This? Somehow to my eyes, this looks a little odd. Okay. So.
That is the other one.
That is the odd one. Okay, so there is a certain amount of time that you associate with identifying one image from the other. And what made the second one difficult was that the difference in the drift was only 15 degrees. Okay? The one of them was drifting in a certain angle, the other one was drifting in an angle which was only 15 degrees away from the one. But the first one I showed was about 60 degrees apart. So there is a certain notion of closeness between such movies that the brain is inherently capturing, and it's trying to take more time on images that are closer. So can I remove this? So, there is a certain relation between the time that you take to identify the odd movie versus the closeness associated between the two images, the non-odd and the odd movies. So, how do we capture this closeness? Okay, is there a way by means which we can capture this closeness? So, for the rest of the talk, what I'll do is, I'll think of each movie that you saw as a sequence of frames. Okay? And one frame is related to the next frame. So there is a certain rate at which these frames are generated, perhaps, okay, maybe 30 FPS, 60 FPS, but whatever is the rate, come down to that fineness in time at which the frames are generated. Frames are generated one after the other. Your eye looks at the frames for however long, so it collects some amount of frames at one location, some amount of frames at another location, and so on. And then eventually your brain identifies that, okay, here is the odd movie. Okay, so for the rest of the talk, what I'm going to do is, a movie for me is a sequence of frames. Okay? Now, this sequence of frames, I'm going to just represent it as a process. Okay, I'm going to collect all of these frames across time, I'm going to identify them as a process. So, here I'm just introducing a small a bit of notation. So the superscript here denotes which location you are looking at. Okay, location 1 will have superscript 1, location 2 will have superscript 2, location 3 will have superscript 3. So let's stick to 3 movies for now. So let's say you looked at movie 1 at the first time instant, movie 2 at the second time instant, movie 3 at the third time instant. Okay, this is without loss of generality, just so that you observed all the movies once. Okay, before you are ready to tell me which movie is the odd one. Let's say you have already looked at all the movies in some sequence. Let's say that sequence is 1, 2, 3 without loss of generality. Now, I'm going to introduce two parameters that are very important in this kind of in analyzing these kind of problems. So what is happening is, when you look at a certain movie and you shift your focus to another movie, that movie where you had initially looked at before, previously looked at, that is still continuing to evolve, right? So there is a certain state in which you had left off that movie, and you come back and continue from a certain other state. Similarly, you shift your focus to some other movie, you shift back, and then you leave that movie in some state. So there is a certain time gap after which you come back to a movie, and then there is a last state from which you continue. Okay, so that movie has already evolved, but in your brain you are still trying to process the new frames. Okay, so you have already left it off at some stage in your brain, you're trying to continue from that state. So that's really what is happening. So the way I try to capture these two parameters is by A, what is called delay, that is the time since you last observed a certain movie, and then B, the last observed state of that movie, the last observed frame of that movie. Okay. So here what I have done is I have indicated that at some time t, so time equal to 0, time starts from 0 for me. Time equal to 0, you selected movie 1. Time equal to 1, you selected movie 2. Time equal to 2, you selected movie 3. Now you are at the start of time 3. What I call delay is how far back in time, how many time instants back did you observe movie 1? It was 3 in time instants back, correct? It was only at time 0. Movie 2, you observed it 2 time instants back at time t equal to 1. Movie 3, you observed it 1 time instant back, just the previous time instant. And whatever you had collected was the last observed state of that. Okay, so this is whatever you had collected at time 0 on movie 1, on time 1 at movie 2, and time 2 on movie 3. Okay, now at time t equal to 3, let's say you chose movie 2. Let's say you chose to look at movie 2. Okay, how does this update now? The number of time instants back in time that you observed movie 1 is now 4. You observed it only at time t equal to 0. Now you are at time t equal to 4. D2, you just observed it in the previous time instant, right? Previous time instant says you observed movie 2. So its delay is 1. Okay? Movie 3, you observed it 2 time instants back. Okay? So the last observed states keep moving. As long as you don't observe a movie, your information about where the movie was stopped is still the same. It has not changed at all. So I1 of t is I1 of t minus 1. I3 of t is I3 of t minus 1. I2 of t though is whatever you collected as the last observed state of movie when you observed it the previous time instant. Now let's say at t equal to 4, you sample movie 1. You choose to look at movie 1. This will get updated accordingly. Okay, so there is a certain pattern that you see here. Exactly one of the delays, the d of t, is exactly one of them is going to be 1. That indicates which one did you observe in the immediately previous time instant. And all the other delays keep getting updated accordingly. Okay, so let's say you choose to observe movie 1 at time 6, its delay is going to get updated. You observe movie 2 at time 7, you observe movie 2 at time 8, you observe movie 1 at time 9, you keep shifting between various movie locations, right? You just update these parameters accordingly. Okay, so this will be useful at a later point of time. I'll come back to this. These are the notions of delays and last observed states. Okay, just have this in your mind. There's a certain evolution of these delays and last observed states according to this rule. Whenever you don't observe, delay increments by 1, and then the last observed state is whatever last information you had retained about that movie. Whenever you observe, its delay is immediately updated to 1, and then its last observed state is updated to whatever you observed just before.
Is the state corresponding to the direction of the movement of
the, so the state here
is it the last frame?
Yeah, so the last frame. So the way it happens is this frame is there. You look at this frame, your brain captures these through certain neuronal firings. So it's the neuronal firings to that particular frame. Okay, whatever was the state of that frame, that is captured in the form of your neuronal firings. That's the state. Okay, so this problem which I showed you, one of detecting the odd movie, can be looked at as a problem of odd arm identification, which I'm about to explain now. Okay, so there is a certain correspondence between this experiment that I showed you and this topic called multi-arm bandits in machine learning. Okay, so the movies that I showed you correspond to the arms of a multi-arm bandit. Okay, think of these as your levers of a certain slot machine. You can pull various levers at various time instants. You pulling a lever corresponds to you selecting a movie location to observe. Okay, now at time t on movie A, you got a certain neuronal response after observing the frame at that movie, right? So that is treated as an observation in a multi-arm bandit. It's an observation that you get by pulling arm A at time t. Okay, now there can be two possibilities. When you can choose to look at only one movie at any given time, right? What is happening to the other movies? You can ask that question. Either those movies can be paused till you come back and play them again, or those movies can continue to keep changing. There are two different scenarios that you can study, right? If you choose to pause the movie and then shift your location to some other place, look at that location, come back, and whenever you come back, you play that movie for one time instant, pause, play for one more time instant only after you come back. So that movie gets played only when you come back. If that is the case, then this is the notion of what is called rested arms in multi-arm bandits. It means all the arms, the states of all the arms are frozen till you come back and observe them again. Okay? If the movies keep continuing to change, it's called the setting of restless arms. Okay, the arms are restless. When we say arms are restless, arms are continuously changing their states whether or not you observe them. Okay? Now, of course, finding the odd movie amounts to finding the odd arm. So now I need to make precise what this oddness in the arm means. For that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take refuge in that experiment I showed you. In that experiment, I told you that each movie is a sequence of frames and one frame is related to the next frame. I capture this dependence between frames via a Markov process. Okay? So I just walk you through steps of analysis that we do, the steps that we take in modeling this problem itself. This itself is very nice. Okay? So we'll do it in a step-by-step manner. First thing is to capture the dependence between the frames in the form of a Markov process. So we are in the setting of odd arm identification with Markov observations. Okay? So you have at least three arms. Only then notion of odd arm makes sense. If there are only two arms, either they are same or they are different. There is no notion of odd man out there. Right? So you should have at least three of them. Now, each arm for me is a collection of frames, as I told you in the movie example, so it's a Markov process. That Markov process, I'm just going to denote it by a sequence of random variables like this. At time t on arm A, what is the observation? Okay, so this you do it for each arm. Now I assume, for the sake of simplicity, that all of these are operating on a finite state space. Okay, so what is the state here? It's the neuronal response, as I said. But in the example that I showed you in the movie, the way it was created was, these dots are placed at some random locations and there is white Gaussian noise which is added to that. So there is a certain drift that is provided to them. This white Gaussian noise makes it uncountably many possible values for the state of each frame. Right? But for the sake of simplicity, for the purpose of analysis, let's bring it down. Let's make it as simple as possible, but no simpler, so that the model is still non-trivial to study. Okay, so we have a finite state space for each Markov chain. Okay? Now, once I describe the Markov, to describe that Markov chain, I need to tell you the transition probability matrix. So the oddness comes from the transition probability matrix for one of the arms being different. So let's say for one of the arms it is P1. This is what I call the odd arm. For rest of the arms, it is some other P2. P2 is not equal to P1. Okay, so in the movie, just go back to the movie whenever you feel all of this is abstract. Okay, in the movie example, one of the movies was moving in a certain direction. You can associate a transition matrix between various frames in that movie. Okay, and then there are other movies and you can associate a corresponding transition matrix for each of those other movies as well. Okay, so there is one of them which is P1, all the others are P2. The goal is to identify which is P1 as quickly as possible. Now, you may ask me, do I know P1 and P2? Well, you may or may not know. Okay? You may or may not know P1 and P2. So, if P1 and P2 are known, there is a certain problem at hand. The only unknown is which arm is the odd arm. Yes? Which movie is the odd movie? I know the P1 and the P2. Okay? If I don't know the P1 and the P2, of course, those two are also unknowns. Which movie is the odd movie is number one. What is the TPM of that odd movie? What is the TPM of all the non-odd movies? That is also, those are also the unknowns. But I don't care about the TPMs. As long as you're able to tell me which movie is the odd movie, I'm good to go. Okay? So, finally what happens is it is a composite hypothesis testing problem. Okay? Ultimately, it will come down to this. Okay? Statisticians can take it forward from here. So, when P1 and P2 are known, all you have to do is identify which is the true hypothesis among these k hypotheses represented here. Okay? Is arm 1 the odd arm? Is arm 2 the odd arm? So there were 8 locations I showed you. Which location has the odd movie there? Okay? H1 through H8 in that example. You have to tell me which location has the odd movie. If at all you don't know P1 and P2, then the problem is a little more complicated, because your unknowns are three of them now. Okay? Odd arm, the transition matrix of the odd arm, the transition matrix of the non-odd arms. So it's like a composite hypothesis test within, you can create some subclasses like this. This is the space of all possible hypotheses. Each element here is a tuple. It's a three element tuple. Okay? There are some which contain the first movie as the odd movie. There are some which have the second movie as the odd movie and so on. It's about identifying the right hypothesis class. I don't want you to pinpoint and tell me this is the exact hypothesis. I don't care whether to what accuracy you report the TPMs, P1 and P2. All I want you to tell me is 1 is the odd arm, 2 is the odd arm. Okay? So it's about this. Okay, so just to give you a big picture of where we stand, all of these problems come under the purview of what is called sequential hypothesis testing. Okay? Sequential hypothesis testing just means you want to identify a certain true hypothesis. For doing that, you have to collect observations. But I don't give you all the observations up front. You ask me whenever you want an observation. Okay? You ask me if you want one observation, I'm going to give you. So that way you can actually optimize the total number of observations you take on an average. Okay? So in this broad framework, we actually sit at the bottom of the table. So my talk here is going to be about this. But just to give you a perspective, there are other problems that are related to this problem that I'm describing. So that movie example that I showed you is a problem of odd arm identification. Okay? Odd man out, arm identification. So there are other problems like best arm identification, where each arm is a process with a certain mean and you identify the one which gives the which has the largest mean. Okay, that is the best arm. So all of these problems can actually be looked at under some broad framework of a general composite hypothesis testing problem. So within this, of course, you can consider the cases where each arm gives either IID observations or Markov observations. As you can see, the movie example is odd arm identification with Markov observations with restless arms. Yes? So this is what I'm going to mostly focus about for the rest of the talk. Okay? So is the setting clear? K movies, one of them different. The goal is to identify which one is different. So the rest of the talk is going to be about this problem. Okay? So this is a recent result that we have submitted to ISID. Okay, so let's prepare the ground for the problem now. So slowly I'm going to walk you through some, I'm going to equip you with some language that you will need to understand the results that we have. Okay, so I'll just slowly walk you through step by step. So we're going to assume P1 and P2 are known. Okay, simplest case. Let's assume P1 and P2 are known. So the only unknown in this problem is the odd arm. Where is the odd arm? Correct? Okay, so there are two quantities that are of interest in such problems. What are those? How much time did you take to identify the odd arm, number one? Yes, that's very important. But when you reported your answer, how correct were you? That is also another thing. Okay, so there are two quantities of interest. Now what people generally do in the literature is they fix one of them and they quantify the other in terms of whatever was fixed. So in this talk, what I'm going to do is I'm going to fix probability of error. And then I'm going to tell you how does this average time that you take to identify the odd arm look like as a function of the given probability of error. And this also I'm going to do, I'm going to let this go to zero and I'm going to tell you at what rate it grows. So smaller the probability of error I give you, perhaps longer you will wait to tell me the answer with that much amount of confidence. Right? You have to be very confident when I give you very small probability of error. So it's intuitive to expect that this time grows as probability of error decreases. At what rate does it grow? Can we capture that growth rate? That's the question. So I'm going to tell you this. So our results are going to be an asymptotic lower bound on this quantity A as a function of the quantity in B. Okay, the asymptotics is as probability of error goes to zero. And I'm also going to give you a sequence of strategies that match this asymptotic lower bound. Okay? Okay, so let's dive deep. So, just a couple of quick notations. Denote that you select arm AT at time T. This is the movie that you are going to observe at time T, AT. Okay? What is the observation that you got by observing the movie AT? That is XT AT at time T. Okay? Now, okay, you have looked at all the movies starting from time 0 until time T. What are you going to do next? Either you are going to stop and tell me which is the odd movie based on all the information you have, or you are going to tell me which movie you are going to look at next. So a policy is just a mapping like this. It tells you which movie to look at next, if at all you are going to look at the next movie, or you are going to just declare that I am done, I am going to tell you which is the odd movie. So let's say policy pi stops at some random time tau of pi, at which time it's going to declare theta of pi, which is the odd movie according to whatever it has gauged. based on all the information that it has acquired until now. Okay? So, our interest is in all those policies which perform very well, given a certain probability of error. You are given a probability of error, let's say epsilon. I am interested in all those policies which at the time of stoppage will tell me that this is the odd arm with very high probability. Okay? In other words, the probability of making error is at most epsilon. Now this has to happen no matter where the odd movie is. I don't know where the odd movie is. I could have placed the odd movie in whichever location I can. There were 8 locations. I never told you where the odd movie is. Irrespective of wherever the odd movie is, my policy should be able to perform very well. Okay? Okay? So from prior works, we know that this expected time that you take to identify the odd movie under policy pi actually grows like log 1 by epsilon, where epsilon is the probability of error. Okay? So what we want to do is precisely capture this constant for the problem of restless Markov arms. Okay? So we expect this behavior. What is this growth rate? Can we capture this growth rate? And what does this growth rate tell about the problem itself? What is the answer to this problem and what does that answer mean for the problem? Okay? So, yeah. So that comes in the constant that we captured. So here, the size of the state space, everything is here.
I mean the growth rate.
Yeah.
The growth rate will have as a parameter size and so on.
Yes.
But we are not in, okay. So you explicitly know like how it isn't that of interest, like how it grows.
So yeah, I mean as of now we have it is, certainly it is. So as I said, in the movie example, the states are very too many of them. Okay. So but what we do is we model only a finite state space case. So there is still that extension to be done, but yes. But that dependence will come out in the final constant, the growth rate, whatever we report as the answer, it comes out there. Okay. Okay, so
what about the number of
arms? Movies? The number of movies. Yeah, so that also appears in this growth rate. So how many movies am I showing you? That also comes as a parameter in this growth rate. So in these visual search experiments, okay, often what is observed is the following. You want to look at a certain location, okay, but then somehow you tend to sample a location that's different from that with a small probability. Mostly you will be focusing where you intend to focus, but you tremble a bit and then you focus at some other point. Okay, so this is what we are going to call as a trembling hand. What is a trembling hand? You intend to focus at location BT. BT here is the arm, okay, the movie location. You intend to focus at a certain location BT, but what actually your eye ends up focusing at is some other location AT. Now how are AT and BT related? AT and BT are equal with a high probability. They are equal with some probability 1 minus eta. Eta is a small parameter. Okay? But with some small probability, your eye actually gets focused to some other location. Okay? So AT is some randomly chosen movie to observe with some probability eta. It's a small probability. So this is what I'm going to call a trembling hand. So now how does your policy look like? What you do is, based on all the information that you have, you decide to look at some point. That's all is there in your control. You decide to look at some movie location. What ends up getting selected is not in your hand. It's a trembled version of what you intended to look at, where you intended to look at. Okay? So you intend to select arm BT, but you end up selecting arm AT. Okay? You can see which arm you selected. Your trembled version, so it selected something else. You can select, you can see what it what got selected. Finally, the observation that you get is from the arm that actually got selected, not the one you intended to select, right? If at all both of them match, then it's okay. So, updated policy is, you intend to select B0, but A0 gets selected. You get an observation, X0, A0. The AT and X's are the same. There is an additional component BT, which is the non-trembled hand. AT is the trembled hand now. Okay? So, P1 at time 1, A1, X1, A1. So, till time t, you have done all of this. Now you must decide where you want to look. That is your intention. You want to look here. Whether that gets selected or not is a different question. Okay? So this is how your policy gets updated now. So with this modified policy, there is a new notion of a state that I want to bring in to describe the problem. Okay, so remember I showed you this table. This table was about last observed states and delays. Okay, so you recall there was a certain evolution about for these delays. When you don't observe a certain movie, the delay for that movie keeps getting incremented till you come back and observe that movie. And the last observed state for that movie is still stale. It's whatever you had last observed it in. Till you come back and observe it in the most recent state, in which case your last observed state gets updated. Yes? So there was a certain notion of last observed states and delays. Now why am I so particular about that? My multi-arm bandit, whatever I have, all the movies that I showed you, can be compactly summarized in this particular vector of delays and last observed states. Okay? This in some sense captures in what state is your system in, according to you. As per the latest information available to you, as per whatever you have observed until now, what is the compact representation of the system for you? In what state is each movie in? How far back in time had you observed each movie? This is the information that you want to take a decision next. Okay? So with this notion of delays and last observed states for each of the movies, okay, notice that giving this full information is equivalent to giving this full thing up to some time. Okay, so my notation is that at t equal to 0, t equal to 1, t equal to 2, up to t equal to k minus 1, I sample the arms in the same order, arm 1, arm 2, arm 3, up to arm k. At time t equal to k onwards, I start computing what is the delay. See, this delay and last observed state doesn't make sense until you have seen each movie once. Correct? You cannot associate the last observed state if you haven't even observed that movie. So I'm going to stand at time t equal to k. This table is for k equal to 3. I'm going to stand at time t equal to k, and I'm going to start computing the last observed states and the delays from that time onwards.
When your hand trembled,
yeah,
do you know which arm you actually pulled? You intended to pull...
I intended to pull BT.
But AT got pulled. Yes. You know...
I know AT.
You know AT.
Yes.
So you know you made a mistake.
Yes. Okay, so giving this full information is same as giving you what is the last observed delays and last observed states up to some time. Yes? Yeah.
Why do we need to look at... Why are we counting the delays after you go through each image once? Because to identify odd arm, I just need 3, right? I can randomly select...
What is... So there are 3 arms, you're saying?
Yeah, so like, if you have more than 3 arms, you are counting delays only after you go through image once, right?
Yeah.
Each image once.
Yes.
But that's not necessary for finding the odd arm.
So his point is that I think he's assuming that if you've looked at the image once, and let's say two of them are the same and one is different, he's able to tell that in the first 3 itself. Then you don't need to look beyond that. So
the thing is, what you get is a state, right? The state, just by looking at a frame, by looking at one frame of that image, if you're able to tell me that is the odd one, okay, well and good. But the point is, just that particular frame may not tell you that is actually the odd one.
What I mean to say is, I can look at a specific location for 2 consecutive frames, 2
yes.
frames, 2 frames, 2 frames.
Yeah.
And with this also, I can, if I know the 2 frames, then I find out at what direction roughly it's going, right?
Mm-hmm.
Then it doesn't make, like, why do we need to count delays only after I go through each image, because I can find odd arms in that
place. No, when I say a delay, what I mean is how far back in time did I sample that. So delay of arm 1 means relative to the current time, in reference to the current time, how far back had I sampled that arm.
So the question is, is it required to do that?
Is it required?
So you are saying that there are policies which, for example, you can just keep looking at some location, focus your attention on some other location, keep looking at that location for some time.
The point is different. So if you have, say, 10 arms, so if you have 10 arms, you are finding the odd one out. So if you actually, after looking at, say, 5 arms, you found that the 5 arms are same. But now you don't want to track this 5 arms, right? Because 4 arms, you know that it's the same.
So you don't need that information. I think the point is you're testing some other algorithm. He's giving one algorithm.
So what I'm doing is, irrespective of what the algorithm is, there is a certain notion of delay for each arm that you can associate. I'm just bringing that out, that's all.
So the operative word is, Nihesh actually used this word roughly. You're able to get things only roughly, you're not certain. If the condition B is such that the probability of error is extremely small, you have to look quite often, you have to be sure about your answer, or close to sure about your answer, before you can declare that it's your. So the initial delays are negligible.
So if I increase that percentage,
what percentage?
Like confidence.
Ideally speaking, for 100% error, you don't even have to look at any of the images.
Correct. So it will result in the same strategy.
All the other extreme, you don't do it once. Spend a lot of time on each of them, the beginning itself, and go over all of them.
Those are possible strategies. Yes. You're going to speak about, no matter what, any strategy will have to wait at least.
So,
there was another query.
The equivalence that you have. So how does it capture the BT in this?
So I should have mentioned the BT. I just realized it. I was about to tell that. So just this is not enough. I need to know the BTs. So this is only going to tell me the arm 80 that was selected and at what time it was selected. So in addition to this, I need to specify the BTs. You're right. Okay, so there is this. You can compactly represent it via the delays and last observed states. Okay, good. So once you have, again, there is a BT. All the BTs have to come here, the past BTs. So past BTs along with this much amount of information, you are going to make a decision on what BT to look at next, which movie to look at next. Your hand trembles, you look at 80, you actually end up sampling 80, selecting 80, you get an observation XT80. Based on that, you can update your delays and last observed states. This keeps happening. Based on this information, you select a BT, you intend to select a BT, your hand trembles, you select 80, you get observation XT80, update your last observed states and delays. Keeps going. Okay? So, the reason I point this nice relationship out is because you can update the last observed states and the delays conditioned on what your BT is and what your previous arm delays and last observed states are. Okay? In other words, this relationship here is capturing a certain control Markov process. Okay? So there is a nice Markov decision problem that comes where you look at these as your new states now. Okay? This state is the state of the full system. Remember, this is not the state of only one arm or anything of that sort. It's a state of the full multi-arm banded system. So this system is in a certain state. You apply a certain action to it, a control, which is your BT. Your hand trembles, something happens inside and out comes 80, XT, 80, and the system state itself changes. Okay? System state changes, apply a new action, system state changes, apply a new action, this keeps happening. Okay? So, we have a very nice Markov decision problem. The Markov decision problem, I need to tell you what is the state space, what's the action space, what's the transition probability. Okay? So, the state space is the set of all possible delays and last observed states. Action space is the set of arms. You apply a control by selecting a certain, intending to select a certain arm. That's your action. The state at time t is your dt, at, whatever it was at time t. Your action is, which arm do you intend to pull? But then that may or may not get pulled. It trembles and something else gets selected. And the observation is, what exactly got selected and what was the observation from that arm at that current time. Okay? But in spite of having a Markov decision problem, our objective is not the standard objective that usually comes up in MDPs. Okay, our objective is to characterize this growth rate. Okay? So, just to sort of get ourselves back on track, we are in the odd movie identification problem. One of the movies is different. We want to identify that movie as quickly as possible. We are given a probability of error. We want to understand how much time we will take. Sorry. We want to understand how much time we are going to take as a function of the probability of error. And we want to capture this growth rate in the asymptotics as your probability of error comes down to zero. Okay? So, notice that if I specify, so there was this nice relationship here that I pointed out. In order to specify a policy now, all I need to do is, if I need to specify this transition. Given this, how do I select this? If I specify that, everything else is taken care of. Okay? So, in order to specify that, we look at a class of stationary policies. What do I mean by that? Again, I should admit my mistake here. I should have all the BTs. The past BTs also should be given to me here. And then I need to select the next location to look at. This is what my policy is doing at each time. Based on all the information I have, I decide where to look at next. Okay? So, this mapping, it could potentially depend on the entire past, but a most general class of policies for which a lot of analysis is available is the one where BT is selected depending on the current state only. Okay? So, BT equal to A, given all the past and all the past BTs, okay, is really selected according to some conditional probability given the current state. Given the current state, which one do you pick? Yeah?
Basic question. If you're assuming Markovian property, do you need to know the violation of BTs or just the current state of BTs?
So, this is a, I'm saying it's a controlled Markov chain, it's not a Markov chain per se. So, the DT, the DT plus 1 and the IT plus 1 at any time may not depend only on the DT and the IT. Given a BT, yes. If I tell you that, look, at this time I selected this arm, you can immediately update based on the past. Okay? But in general, your delays and last observed states at any given time could potentially depend on the entire history of all the delays and last observed states in the past.
I meant BT, not DT.
BT. Yeah.
BT is your action.
Yeah.
Your control action.
Yes. So what is the question? What is Markovian?
To maintain the, or remember the evolution of BT or...
So I could potentially select arm BT based on whatever I have selected in the past as well. But what I'm saying is, if it is a stationary randomized strategy, a SRS policy of a particular type here, then what happens is it selects arm BT only based on the last, only on the previous delays.
And I'll articulate this question. Yeah. So you're going to add to the history BS minus 1.
Yeah.
Also. And then you let k less than or equal to s less than or equal to t. And so in here in the lambda a given dt, it, will you have bt minus 1? I think that's his question.
Oh no, that won't be there. So
that's all, I think that's all his question is.
Okay, so if it's a stationary randomized policy, is that particular type of a policy which takes decision only based on the current state. Okay, it doesn't look at the past actions, the past states. Okay, so it's only based on the current state. So if that is the case, if it's only based on the current state, then what happens is, okay, so just one second. So let's say we have a stationary randomized strategy, okay, an SRS policy. Now this is the way in which you intend to select. Lambda is a certain probability distribution according to which you intend to select an arm. But does it actually get selected that way? With a trembling hand, what gets selected at the end is according to this distribution. With probability 1 minus eta, yes, according to the distribution you intended to select, it will get selected. But with probability eta, a uniformly randomly chosen arm gets sampled. So this is a trembled version of what you intended to select. Okay? So whatever is the SRS policy like this, I'm going to call it as pi lambda, and then pi SRS is, yeah.
Trembling arm is implicitly a formulation or is
yeah.
So, but then this trembling is supposed to, I mean, it can help you with the way it's set, it's exploring uniformly.
Yeah, correct. So, in order to have that feature of exploration, forced exploration, so one thing is.
So, why do you use it uniform is my question. When you tremble, why do you uniformly sample?
So, we want some means by which we select each arm with a strictly positive probability. So,
I mean, is trembling something you want, or is trembling there?
No, trembling is built into the problem. Trembling is there already. Okay, so whenever you select, your hand trembles. Okay, there is some trembling that is observed in practice in some visual search experiments.
The beta model would be an sort of adversarial distribution. You tremble rather than uniform one. So then, I think uniform may help you there. But that's fine. Still, remarkable.
So the thing is, this plays a very crucial role in our analysis. In the sense, the fact that we are sampling each arm with a probability that's strictly bigger than zero, in this way, is actually going to help us a lot. Okay, I'll tell you one very nice implication of this.
That is my point.
Yeah.
It will have a lot of nice implications.
Yeah, certainly. So,
is this trembling needed to characterize the constant?
This constant?
You showed a constant.
Yeah. So, that constant will have the trembling built into it. Okay. So, whether we need that in order to characterize that constant for a problem like this, for a problem where we are going to characterize the growth rate for this, we are going to characterize it with the trembling hand. I'm going to tell you what happens if there is no trembling hand. What happens when you go to characterize a constant like that without a trembling hand?
This trembling probability, does it decrease over time?
No, it's fixed.
It's fixed.
This is a function of your hand or your eye. So it's fixed. Throughout it's fixed. Okay? Yeah. So the nice property about this trembling hand is the following. Under you take any SRS policy, I told you that there is a controlled Markov process. Now it's actually a Markov process. Because your BT is going to depend only on the current state. Okay? So your next DT IT is going to depend only on the DT minus 1 IT minus 1. So it's a Markov process. Further, if the trembling hand parameter is strictly positive, you can actually show that this Markov process is ergodic. Okay? So it's irreducible, aperiodic, and positive recurrent. So this ergodicity crucially uses the fact that your trembling hand parameter is strictly positive. Okay? So there is a system, that system is evolving in a Markovian fashion now. The state of that system is evolving in a Markovian fashion. You are applying controls, it's evolving. The evolution is Markovian. And it's ergodic. As time approaches infinity, it's going to reach some stationarity. Okay? So let's call the stationary distribution as mu lambda. Now, the system is in a certain state, you apply action. I want to compute this joint probability of the system being in some state and you applying some action. Okay, that is this ergodic state action occupancy.
So SRS policy can be
used,
but you're forgetting the history. What was it?
So SRS is BT is selected only based on DTIT.
The current state
of the system. Yeah.
So is your probability matrix, is it stationary or is it changing over time?
So that's the thing. It's if your policy is a SRS policy with the trembling hand parameter strictly positive, transition matrix is a time homogeneous transition probability matrix and it has a unique stationary distribution. Is that the question?
Is the P, the resulting P for the CMP, it's a Markov process, is it changing with time?
No. It's a time homogeneous change. So the transition matrix is not a function of time.
At lambda?
Given DT,
At lambda, in the previous slide, SRS lambda,
yeah.
That is also not a function of time. Lambda A given D.
No, lambda is a fixed lambda.
Fixed. Yeah. So it doesn't see the T either. It doesn't know what's the time, how long you've run.
No. So based on the current state, lambda operates and lambda of A given, what is the current state?
That's why the terminology stationary comes for the SRS policy. So
we are assuming that this transition probability are stationary.
You're assuming lambda is stationary.
Yes.
So it does not change with time.
Yes, correct.
So then my question is that, why is it only happening that when eta is positive, then only you get an ergodic process? Why not otherwise? So your next statement says that if neta is greater than 0, then your process is ergodic, right?
Mm.
What happens when neta is equal to 0? Is it necessarily non-ergodic?
So ergodic has many aspects to it. One is you should be able to go from any state to any other state with a strictly positive probability. Mm-hmm. Okay, that is the irreducibility part of ergodicity. Okay, and then of course there is aperiodicity and then positive recurrence. So if you want to come to irreducibility, what happens is you want to select according to lambda. Okay, now this conditional distribution lambda may not put a strictly positive probability on each arm. That is, there may not be a strictly positive probability of selecting every arm. So let's say you always select arm A, arm 1. Okay, always your lambda is such that lambda of dot given whatever it is always a point mass at arm 1. Only that is going to get selected forever, right? So the delay of arm 1, all the other delays are just going to continuously keep on increasing. If you want to look at some other vector of delays and last observed states, there is no way of you getting back there.
But you can impose a restriction that this corner cases do not arise, whether any of the lambda can.
So the point is, we do not know what policies are optimal in this setting. So we are in a search for optimal policies, that is policies which can get us this job done of identifying the odd movie as quickly as possible. Okay, so
one of
because
the optimal policies can have this property that you just mentioned, and that's why you are putting the
even though an optimal policy has that, because of the trembling hand, there is a lot of exploration that happens, and eventually you are able to identify the odd arm because you explore all the movie locations. So that eta positive mainly is for this exploration, that there is a strictly positive probability of selecting each arm at any time instant. Okay, so I'm going to now show you the lower bound. So we have built all the language, I hope so. Okay, so with this, what's the lower bound? Fix an odd arm H. This is the movie, this is the location of the movie which is odd. P1 is the TPM of that odd movie. P2 is the TPM of all the non-odd movies. Okay, so PHA, by PHA I'm going to refer to the TPM of arm H at TPM of arm A under hypothesis H. Okay, that is when H is actually the odd arm, you select arm A, what is its TPM? Okay, that is PHA, and there will be certain powers of this TPM that will come because of this delay. Okay, you are observing a certain Markov chain only after D steps perhaps, so you need to compute those D step transitions in that Markov chain. Because of that, some dth powers will come. So the lower bound is this constant, this particular thing grows at least as much as this, where the R star is. So R star has a very nice interpretation here. You decide to operate according to some policy lambda. Okay, your hand trembles. On an average, in the long term, you're going to see a state di of the system, and you're going to apply action A according to this probability. Now whenever the system is in that state, that is, you have left the system in some state, right? Whenever a system is in that state, the odd movie and the non-odd movie are close in this sense. Okay, so this is the transition probability of the D step transition probability under arm A. So you have left that arm in a certain state, IA, last observed state. Its delay is DA. Okay, so under hypothesis H versus hypothesis H prime, there is a certain notion of closeness between the movie, this state of that arm. Okay, so there is a certain nearest alternative to your true hypothesis, that is your min over all H prime. You need to battle against the nearest alternative, that is, you need to guard yourself against identifying the nearest alternative. Okay, so you need to select according to a certain policy that keeps your nearest alternative as far away as possible. If you do that, you will be able to identify the odd movie in this much. This is the growth rate at which the time you take to identify the odd movie looks like. Okay, fine. So notice that your R star doesn't depend on the movie location.
The policy that looks at history, this is looking only at pi lambda, which forgets the history. There may be a better policy that looks at history.
Entire history.
So is it possible?
So there is the parameter eta. So
eta is there.
So I am as of now restricting attention only to SRS policies. So that SRS itself forgets the history. The current arm BT is going to be only a function of what the current state of the system is.
That is in this optimization problem. But your lower bound, does it restrict attention to?
Yes, it restricts attention only to SRS policies. That is policies which sample the lambda, whatever we had. Pi lambda is according to lambda. You intend to select according to lambda. Lambda is an SRS policy. So I write pi lambda just to write that lambda as a policy pi.
So it doesn't depend on the SR score. For any policy, this is the lower bound.
No, these pi epsilon, policies in pi epsilon are SRS policies for me. So it is only over those SRS policies that I'm computing this bound.
If eta go to 0, this
R star
go to 0 or
flow? So this, I'll come to that. So this is actually an increasing function as eta goes to 0. I'll just highlight that. Okay, so this is what we call as the metric. This is what we want to say is the closeness between odd movie and a non-odd movie that your mind tries to capture, that your brain tries to capture, okay? So I think I'm running out of time. So what I'll do is I'll quickly highlight our policy. So this R star, if you saw, there was a supremum over all policies. So it's not clear if there is an SRS policy that achieves this supremum, okay? So because it's a supremum, you can always attain it arbitrarily closely. You can come arbitrarily close to that supremum, okay? So the way you do it is, for every delta, there always exists one SRS policy such that it's more than this pi 1 plus delta. That you know because it's a supremum. Okay, just take that policy and then you do a simple log likelihood ratio based test, okay? Wherein you look for, you maintain a guess of what the odd arm is at each time, okay? And you look at the test statistic of that particular arm against all the other arms. If that test statistic has exceeded a certain threshold, you are very confident that that is your true odd arm. Stop and declare that that's the true odd arm. Otherwise, you take one more sample, and the way you're going to take the next observation is according to a certain distribution that depends on what your guess of the odd arm is. Okay. So I know I was very fast here, but essentially this is a version of your generalized likelihood ratio test which works. And then for this, we are able to show an upper bound. Okay.
This is not an SRS policy, right?
Which one?
Your lambda keeps changing with your... It's assumed your lambda wouldn't change with time. But here, lambda is a parameter, is a function of your theta hat of n.
Yes.
Can you go back to your definition of pi epsilon?
Pi epsilon.
You didn't say anything about SRS here. So it's actually any policy. And the reason why it works is that you'll only depend on the ergodic occupation measures. And you look at constraints of in transitions into a state and out transitions into a state. And every in must match an out. And therefore, the measure must be, if you look at just the occupancy measure for any policy, that occupancy measure for any policy can be written in terms of an equivalent SRS. So actually here, pi epsilon is any policy, and so your lower bound is actually valid for any policy. And in fact, that's the content of the lower bound. Can you go back to that theorem that you put, the lower bound theorem? The content of that theorem is actually that that policy on the left is any arbitrary policy, but on the right, you come up with an optimization problem that focuses only on SRS. Okay, so a static rule like this suffices to get the lower bound.
But the policy should result in some kind of convergence.
It doesn't matter. So he actually looks at only limits there.
So can you suggest like what? So can you repeat what you said again? So what is the construction of that station, like SRS policy?
So if you look at that policy, what that policy is going to yield a certain occupancy of D and I states, and an action A. Now you look at that state occupancy measure. So that state occupancy measure, after a certain, you're looking after you stop, you basically accumulate the cost associated with that as well. So if it is a policy within less than or equal to epsilon, then you can essentially say that the actual stopping time is bigger than or equal to this multiplied by log 1 over epsilon. And this multiplied by log 1 over epsilon comes from your actual policy had a certain state occupancy measure. It might be non-Markovian, but nevertheless it has a certain state occupancy measure. you lower bound it by the best, this comes in the denominator, so you upper bound it by the best state occupancy measure. But once you have a best state occupancy measure, you can view that as an SRS policy, because you can disintegrate that into a state occupancy measure followed by an action given that state. So you can view it as an SRS policy. So this lower bound is actually quite strong because it doesn't put a restriction on SRS policy. And the key content of this is that it's enough to focus on SRS. But as far as the upper bound is concerned, the achievability part is concerned, you don't, you just want an achievable policy. You don't necessarily want it to be SRS, but you use the SRS to build a non-SRS policy that's moving towards the correct one. Even asymptotically, it is SRS, because once you are sort of in the correct theta hat of N, from then on you're not changing. So at that point of time, it becomes SRS. But you don't know when that has happened. Okay, so is it clear? Are you convinced or not?
So at least as far as I recall, in the derivation of the bound, I make use of the fact that every policy in pi epsilon has that property that the d's, the delays and last observed states, are a Markov chain indeed.
In the lower bound?
Yeah, in the lower bound, when I derive the ergodic state occupancy measure, there comes a point where I have to say that it's a Markov process. There is a certain ergodic state occupancy associated with that. But you are saying for that policy, there is an equivalent SRS policy that matches its performance.
Do the optimization, there is an equivalent SRS policy. So you lower bound it by this optimization. In this R star, you will upper bound.
Yeah, yeah.
By a joint state occupancy measure. That defines an equivalent SRS policy.
Okay. So I haven't thought this through completely.
So algorithmically, everything is anchored to a good SRS policy. So at least the algorithm that you presented means, what you said was that if you give me a SRS policy, then I can construct another policy which does what? Which gives what performance?
No, so if you give me a delta, so the lower bound has a supremum.
That's right. So some policy you chose. Forget about it. You chose the best one, that's a different one.
Yeah, yeah.
You choose enough.
So once you do this, this is under the assumption that H is the order. So I don't know what is the order. So at each time, I have to go back and look for this policy corresponding to which arm is the order according to me.
So for each H, you have a policy.
Yes.
For each H, you have a lambda.
Yeah. Okay. So for each H, when H is the order, I have a lambda. But I don't know what the true H is when I'm actually solving the problem. So at each time instant, I maintain a guess theta hat n of what is the order. Now for this being the order, I go back and solve that lambda. I have a lambda for each H, right? For theta hat n, I just go back and solve for the lambda. I get that lambda.
Is this lambda the most discerning in some sense for that H? Is that what that lambda H is? That it is the best one to use?
Correct, yes. This, now you are going to tremble with this. This is the one that you intend to pick because it's the most discerning for your current case of what the order is. And then you tremble and then everything happens.
It's also the most discerning, knowing that you tremble.
Okay, so our policy actually has this sort of an upper bound, and then here delta is some parameter that you choose in order to ensure whatever degree of accuracy you want to the lower bound. Okay, the lower bound is a supremum. So your upper bound can come arbitrarily close to the lower bound, and that arbitrariness is captured by a delta, and then you can set your parameter L to achieve the desired probability of error. So this policy also has that feature. Okay, so delta is arbitrary, and then through a sequence you can always approach that lower bound. Okay, so this is the main result. So this is what we intended to capture, and that constant is precisely 1 by R star. Okay, the one that I showed you. So this is for the restless setting. So I'll just take 5 minutes. I'll just tell what happens when you don't have a trembling hand. Okay, so when you don't have a trembling hand, so these were the set of trembled policies that you were looking at before. Okay, so this has a very nice property. This property is that if you take a smaller trembling hand parameter, all the policies that were there before are also there in the new trembling hand policy, are also there in the new trembled world. Okay, so there is a this set of policies will keep growing, and you expect that, right? Because here all the policies are required to have a probability of at least eta by k on each arm. You reduce that eta, make eta equal to zero, for example. This is all possible policies. Okay, so the space of policies keeps growing, and that is indeed the case. Okay, now once this happens, whatever I showed as the bound R star, just call it R eta star for explicit, for just for clarity, call it as R eta star when eta is the trembling hand parameter. Okay, so because this happens, and then that R star was actually a supremum over this policy space, all trembled policies with parameter eta. Okay, so there is some monotonicity here, which is R eta star grows, okay, as eta tends to zero. Now, of course, you can tell me, I'll just plug eta equal to zero in that R star expression, and then I'll just treat that as the lower bound. The point is, can you achieve that lower bound? Okay, zero is always a lower bound, right? For all such problems. Can you achieve zero? That's the question. Of course, the answer is no. So the thing is, you can plug in eta equal to zero, but can you achieve that? So let's say you plug in eta equal to zero and you have this quantity. Now from that monotonicity property, all we know is this holds. Okay? This R eta star, it just keeps growing, and it's less than or equal to R zero star. Okay, R zero star is what you obtain by plugging eta equal to zero. So you let eta go to zero, does it in a smooth way merge with R zero star is the question. Okay, for any eta, yeah.
Confused. What's going on operationally? Can't you emulate this eta? You can artificially tremble. So why can't you achieve?
So I mean, artificially tremble in the sense?
Because your analysis works for even the lower bound is it use that eta.
It uses eta, yeah.
You can artificially tremble, but you can't artificially untremble. So R zero is larger.
Yeah. So the thing is, for every eta, so look at it this way: for every eta, R eta star is achievable through a sequence of policies. Yes, you can come arbitrarily close to R eta star. Now R eta star itself is moving to the right; it's increasing. Now there is an R zero star. Potential R0 star, your R eta star is going, your policies are all converging to R eta stars arbitrarily closely, but does your R eta star make a jump or is there a smooth transition is the question.
Another way to say this might be, you know that R eta star always involves an ergodic policy, but let's say that the best policy is a non-ergodic policy, then you can't, and that might have a jump, so you might not be able to prove. Sometimes you can, but maybe sometimes you cannot.
Okay, so all we are asking is this an equality? If this is an equality, yes. Okay, so in some sense, can we show that, so the reason I write right continuity is because, yeah, okay. So the reason I write right continuity here is for some reason which comes from prior works. In the prior works, we show that the above inequality is actually an equality. Okay, so our lower bound is a very general lower bound. When specialized to the settings of prior works, we are able to recover the respective lower bounds in those works. Okay, so in those cases, I just quickly run through, in the case when you have IID observations, your R eta star will look something like this. Okay, I'm not going to go into the details, but the point is your objective function here is linear in eta. Okay, so it's an absolutely continuous function, and there is this very nice envelope theorem that you can use to show that R eta star, the resulting optimization, the value is also absolutely continuous in eta. Now, because it's absolutely continuous, it will go smoothly merge with the R zero star. Similarly, when you have rested arms, that is when your movies are paused, in that case also you can show that it's just a linear function, okay? And then there is this nice absolute continuity that again comes out, and envelope theorem will tell you that it merges smoothly. But the problem is, for the restless setting, does this happen? Does it merge smoothly or not is the question, okay? So we don't yet have an answer for that, okay? It requires verifying certain technical conditions. So what will happen when P1 and P2 are unknown? Here I assume that P1 and P2 are known, okay? So there is this additional technical difficulty that will come when P1 and P2 are not known, and you have to learn them along the way. So we'll have to explore these directions. So these are for future work. Okay, so with that I conclude. Thanks.